Thank you. So yeah, I would like to present this library, Ecole, which is developed within the data science for real-time decision-making research chair here in Montreal. So it's André Allody's research chair. And yeah, I'm gonna talk about why this library and how it works. So I would like to start first with introducing my view of combinatorial optimization solvers. So when I say that Ecole is meant for machine learning, for combinatorial optimization, I specifically mean mixed integer linear programs. So currently Ecole is restricted to this kind of problems. So I think you all know very well what's a MILP. There has been plenty of talks today which introduced it already. So basically it's a linear program with some with the addition of some integrality constraints on some of the variables. While it appears simple, it's actually a very versatile modeling tool. A lot of real-world applications can be formalized as MILPs. And also it's NP-hard to solve in general MILPs. So what's exact solving for MILPs? So exact solving consists of two parts. First, you have to be able to produce upper bounds. So I'm considering minimization problems here. So an upper bound is a feasible solution. If you can provide a solution which satisfies all of the constraints in your problem, that it's feasible, it has an objective value, you know that you can at least do that well. It's an upper bound. On the other side, some algorithms allow you to get lower bounds on your optimization problems. For example, if you solve a linear programming relaxation, you get a lower bound. You know that there is no feasible solution better than that bound. And basically, an exact solver provides you those two things, an upper bound on the primal side and a lower bound on the dual side. And it's gonna improve, it's gonna refine those bounds over time. So it can be using bunch and bound, using cutting planes, or whatever other algorithm which can provide such bounds. And basically, you say that you solved an instance when you reach this first criterion, when L equals U. When your upper and lower bounds meet, then you have a feasible solution and you have a guarantee that there is no better solution. And that's it. It may be also that your problem is infeasible, in which case you will end up with a lower bound, an infinite lower bound. You prove that there is no feasible solution. But exact solving sometimes you don't even need to find the optimal solution. You may want to stop when you reach a certain threshold, which I call a regret certificate. Like if I give you a solution to your problem and I guarantee you that you cannot improve over that solution for more than 1%, then you know that you have little regrets, right? If you go for this solution, you know that, okay, maybe you could get 1% more, but no more than that. So it's also a very good thing to have. So, yeah, this is what I mean by exact solving. In order to do that, to do exact solving, to have those two bounds getting close to each other, several methods exist. The most widely used is bunch and bound, which has been presented already today, which recursively decomposes the problem into smaller ones. So basically, you build this bunch and bound tree by adding inequality constraints over the variables. You split the feasible space in two, then in two, then in two, and so on. And this tree gives you both upper bounds and lower bounds. And it is guaranteed to end. Worst case, you're gonna explore the whole feasible space of your problem. but there are some non-trivial decisions to take here. Depending on which nodes you select or which variables you choose to branch, you may end up with a very large bunch and bound tree or a smaller bunch and bound tree. And those decisions, no one has figured out yet what is the optimal way to decide on those. So those are really arbitrary decisions. So in branch and bound, you have those decisions which you must take. In exact solvers, which uses branch and bound, you also have a bunch of other components in which decisions have to be taken. For example, in commercial solvers, you run primal heuristics, which are generic search routines that you run once in a while when you're at a node that will search for a while and try to find feasible solutions. So again, you can ask yourself, okay, which heuristics should I run now? When should I run those heuristics? Because running a heuristics is costly. So again, you have decision problems. Another component is cuts, which was the topic of the previous talk. So within branch and bound, you can also add cuts to tighten the linear program relaxation of your MIL. So there exist routines which are guaranteed to, which would generate cuts, which are guaranteed to remove a portion of the feasible space without removing any integer variable. So you can add cuts this way. But then an open question is, which cuts do you actually want to add to the LP? Because many of the cuts will be actually, will make very little progress, and many of them will be redundant. If you add too many cuts, you will end up with numerical instabilities in your problem. So maybe you don't want to add all of them. So that's also a question that you have to answer when you build a solver. Another important part in exact solvers is pre-processing. So again, you have pre-processing routines which you can run that will try to shrink your MIL, try to fix some variables if it can deduce that some variables can be fixed, maybe remove some redundant constraints and so on. And again, which routines should you run for a specific MIL, how many times? Pre-processing can be costly, but maybe you want to spend this time because it's gonna save you time later on. And again, there is no clear answer to which pre-processing routines work best for which problems. So I talked about all those decision problems just to illustrate that in an exact solver, you have to take all those decisions in sequence. And depending on which decisions you take, this is going to affect how the lower bound is going to go up over time and how the upper bound is going to go down over time. So it's going to affect the way you're going to solve the instances. And it's a very complex problem to design a solver. So you have to decide on a node selection strategy, variable selection strategy, cutting plane strategy, primal heuristics, pre-processing, even the way you initialize the simplex solver. It's an arbitrary decision that you take. And to make things even harder, there is no clear objective way to evaluate a solver. So there are many metrics in the literature. People look at the branch and bound tree size. You like to have it small, but also the solving time. But maybe for some instances, you cannot even solve them. So solving time is meaningless. So you can look at the primordial integral, how fast you close the gap. Maybe you just care about the dual part, about proving optimality. Maybe you just care about having good feasible solutions fast. In which case you only look at the primal integral. So all of those are valid metrics, and there is no consensus really in which one is best. And the state of affairs in existing commercial solvers is basically expert rules and benchmarks. So people try to be clever and try to design good rules which make sense and which should be good. And then they just evaluate those on some benchmarks, some internal benchmarks, which is usually their properties. They will not share their benchmark. And they decide on, okay, this is the best set of rules to solve my benchmarks on average. So it's very, very empirical. And here comes Ecole. So ECOL stands for Extensible Combinatorial Optimization Learning Environments. So the idea is that we would like to provide learning environments for people to replace those expert rules by rules learned from data, using machine learning, using reinforcement learning. So this is a Python library, and also we want it to be extensible because we don't want to decide on what are the right learning environments that people should look into. We want people to be able to add their own environments into the library as well. So why ECOL? If you look at the field of machine learning for combinatorial optimization, there are already plenty of papers out there which address all of the decision problems which I mentioned: node selection, variable selection, cutting planes. So it looks like things are going well. So why would you need a library to solve those problems? Basically, to address those three issues in the field. So first, there is a poor reproducibility in the field. It's the state of the field now. It's kind of in a reproducibility crisis, right? All the papers which I mentioned in the previous slide, they are hard to reproduce. Each paper will use its own solver, sometimes a commercial closed source solver. Sometimes they just won't give the code because of that. They evaluate on their own benchmarks. They re-implement their own metrics, and it's not trivial to implement a metric in combinatorial optimization. So if you want to, let's say you have a new idea for learning to branch, and you want to compare to the competitors, right, to previously proposed approaches, it's going to be super hard for you to do just because you have to re-implement everything, basically. It's not a fair way to compare. So that's an issue. A second issue is the high bar of entry for newcomers. So all those traditional combinatorial optimization solvers are implemented in fast C, C++ code. If you want to interact with them in some specific parts, you will have to use low-level C or C++ code. So this is very different from the machine learning ecosystem, which relies heavily on Python and standard APIs, NumPy, PyTorch, and so on. So there is some engineering work to do here. And also, it's just highly technical because solvers, the way they are implemented, it's not at all the same as what you will read in a textbook, right? The bunch and bound algorithm seems pretty simple. But when you look at implementations, it's not at all simple. So if you want to jump into a new project with machine learning for combinatorial optimization, you will spend a lot of time just digging in the code of the solver and debugging your code. So there is a high cost of entry. And and last, another issue that we would like to address is that there is still a gap between the machine learning and the OR communities. Because machine learning people who want to tackle OR problems, they don't know much about combinatorial optimization or solvers, so they tend to use simplified versions of solvers or even re-implement their own solvers. And this gives rise to criticism in the OR community, like, okay, they say that they beat the baseline by 50%, but look at their baseline, it's a garbage solver. So this is an issue. And the other way around, also, people in the OR communities who try to use machine learning tools, they tend to use simple tools just because they don't have access to complicated tools, or it's hard enough to just interface with linear regression. So don't even think about big neural networks or reinforcement learning. It's out of reach. So there is a need for a standard open platform for machine learning for combinatorial optimization, which is based on a state-of-the-art solver. So ECOL aims for that, and it reuses the open source KIP solver, which, as was said previously today, is basically the most competitive open source solver out there. And it's really state of the art. You have everything in Skip, you have cuts, you have branching rules, you have primal heuristics, you have all the things that modern solvers have. Skip has it. So the whole point of ECOL is to basically remove all the technical obstacles for machine learning, for combinatorial optimization practitioners, so that we can focus on the actually interesting challenges, like which models are best suited, which tasks are interesting, like does it work? Let's just run some benchmarks. We don't want to spend months just debugging code. So in order to implement such a library, we went for a standard formulation for all of those problems. Because designing a combinatorial optimization solver is essentially a sequential control problem, right? You take branching decisions one after the other, or you select cutting planes one after the other. So all of those can be naturally formulated as Markov decision processes. So here the agent would be the environment would be the solver, Skip. And the agent is your code, your policy, like, the solver gives you some information about, say, variables, and then you decide on a variable to branch, and you send that variables to the solver. And we aim for, basically, we want to hide the environments. If you want to tackle a learning to branch task, you just have to implement the agent. You just have to care about the information that you get in, the information that you give out, and you don't want to care about the specifics of the solver itself. So, so in this framework, the state would be basically the state of the solver, like the whole memory of the computer program. This is your state. The actions would be, depending on the task, variables, nodes, or cuts, or whatever. And we will talk about an episode. So when you run an MDP, you start in an initial state. So you have a distribution over the initial states. This will depend on which problems you tackle. Maybe you just care about some families of problems. And also, like the pre-processing, say you do branching, Skip will, you just feed an instance to Skip. It does all the pre-processing stuff, and it gets you into this initial state. Then you have a transition probability in this MDP, how to go from one state to the next, given that you take an action. So this is also handled by the solver and by ECOL. And when you have a call, the only thing you have to implement is this policy, how to take an action given a state. And that's it. And really, a call tries to follow this this formulation as close as possible. One thing we went for also is that you cannot really use an MDP here for the simple reason that the state is the whole memory of the solver. And you cannot really just feed that into a machine learning model. So what you will tend to use is a simplified view of the solver. You are just going to extract meaningful features for your task. So in that case, instead of collecting states, you collect observations, which are somehow a subset of the state, just a reduced amount of information. And you just fall into the partially observable Markov decision process framework, which is well established in machine learning. So how does it look like? So to give you an idea, this is the standard OpenAI GYM library, which is used heavily in reinforcement learning. So it's very simple. You load an environment, say you want to play the game Space Invader. And then you loop, and you will just play episodes. So you reset the environment, you start the game, you get into the initial state, you get the initial observation. And while you're not done, while the game has not stopped, you pick up the next action by asking your policy, and you feed it into the environment by calling the step function. And the environment is going to update itself and give you back the next observation, also a reward, how well you did for this step. Are you done yet? And an info field for if you want to debug stuff. So we went pretty much for this API. This is the ECOL API. So the Skip solver will be responsible for the reset and the step functions. And it's going to give you an observation, an action set. So in the case of branching, for example, it's going to give you the set of branching variable candidates, which you can pick, or it could be a set of cuts or whatever. And the loop is exactly the same. You choose the next action given an observation, and you feed that into the environment, and you get the next observation, next action set, a reward, and so on. So when you give this kind of API to reinforcement learning people, they're happy. It's all they need to just implement a reinforcement learning algorithm. And you see here, Skip is completely hidden. You don't even have to know what is the solver underneath. So Ecole also tries to, I mean, Ecole does feature a few things. First, it's open. We went for the BSD free license, so you can do pretty much whatever you want with Ecole. It's easy to use. It's a Python interface. You can install it in one line via the Conda package manager, or you can also just compile it yourself if you want. It's fast. It's entirely written in C++, and it's bind to Python using PyBind 11, but the whole implementation is in C++. And it's thread safe, which is nice if you want to do reinforcement learning and just sample a lot of trajectories in parallel. It's extensible. You can expand the library in C++ if you want to keep things fast, but you can also just expand it in Python using the PySkipOpt library to interface with the solver. It's also modular, so it's very Pythonic, like you can combine things together. Say you have a reward function that has been defined for a specific task for branching, then you can just reuse that reward function for cutting planes. You can compose reward functions together, like you see here. When you define an environment, this is the branching environment. You say, okay, my reward function is, and this is number of LP iterations squared minus 3 times number of nodes. So maybe it doesn't make much sense, but you can do things like that very easily. You can prototype super easily a new reward functions. You have to pick an observation function. So this is a node bipartite observation function, which Laurent presented earlier, which is already implemented in the library, but you can just design your own observation function if you want. If you have some specific features that you want to compute, you can just implement that and feed that into the environment. And optionally, you can also set some parameters for Skip if you want to put your environment in a specific scenario. Like you can deactivate preprocessing or cuts if you want. So it's very easy to use. What's inside the library at the moment? So we have two environments. Configuring, basically, you can do parameter tuning with this environment. It's just a bandit problem. There's just one step. You choose parameters, it solves, and it gives you back the final reward. We also have the branching environment, which has been presented earlier by Laurent, but also by Vinod. We have a few rewards, so some natural rewards, solving times, number of nodes, number of LP iterations, also, which you may want to minimize. We have a few observation functions, so two from the literature, not bipartite, and also the features from the paper from Khalil, who did the learning to branch on single instances, and a bunch of others. And we also have in the library what we call instance generators. So we picked some standard instance generators from the literature, the ones we had used in our NeurIPS paper. And we implemented them in C++, so they're fast and they're reproducible. If you set the same seed and you generate instances, you're gonna have the exact same instances. So you can, if you reuse the same instance generator as a paper, you are guaranteed that you use the exact same instances. And you can just change the size of those instances if you want, make them bigger or smaller. You can parameterize those generators. So you can check all of those features online because the library is available and we have a nice documentation page where everything is detailed. So to conclude, Ecole is a library which exposes control problems in exact CO solvers through a simple GYM-like API so that people can just run reinforcement learning or imitation learning or whatever algorithms using this API. You don't even have to do machine learning. You can just prototype some quick decision rules that you would like to try in Python and just run on some benchmarks and evaluate it as well. So it's useful also, even if you don't want to use machine learning. It's based on Skip, and it provides as well standard benchmarks, standard metrics, and feature sets, which we try to add as it goes. And what next? So we'd like to keep expanding the library by providing new environments, for example, a learning to cut environment. There are already a few papers about that, or a local search environment, which is similar to what Vinod presented earlier, where you would like to feed Skip a partial, to feed the environment, say, a partial solution. And then you ask, okay, please, fill this solution by using this heuristic or that heuristic or that heuristic, and you can do some dynamic local search this way. We like to provide some new reward functions like the primal dual integral. It's on the map. It should come soon. We like to provide as well real world instance collections because until now we only have synthetic instances, which is a bit sad. And something I really care about is once we have this library with standard benchmarks, metrics, and so on, then we can very easily set up a competition, an open competition in a conference, say NeurIPS or whichever conference, and just provide the API, tell participants, okay, you can use this API, this is the benchmark, and train your models and send us the results. So it's something also we are aiming for with this library. That's pretty much it. So here are the current contributors to the library. And if you're interested, please try it, download it, try to use it with your students or for your research. If you have new ideas for environment, instead of starting from scratch, maybe you just want to implement that into Ecole, so that it's available to everyone. And yeah, please feel free to use it. Thanks.